Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Svetomir Stoyanov and I'm going to talk about containers, Kubernetes, Linux kernel tracing and how we can mix all this together. I'm an open source engineer currently working for VMware. During the years, I have contributed to many different projects in many domains, including Linux kernel tracing, both in the kernel space and the ecosystem around it in the user space. Also in some IoT and tech related projects, and also recently started with my first contributions to some projects in the machine learning domain. Short agenda of what I'm going to speak today. First, I will do a brief overview of the currently existing approaches used to trace containers in Kubernetes cluster. After that, we'll go briefly to the tracing capabilities of the Linux kernel, how they work, and how we can use them to trace containers in user space. After that, I will introduce the container tracer, a project that I started at the beginning of this year. And at the end, there is a short pre-recorded demo to show you how all this works. So let's start. Currently, a lot of tools and frameworks exist that are used to trace containers running Kubernetes cluster. There are two typical tracing scenarios, tracing our application during the development and tracing in production. Usually during the development, we want to verify that the application works in the way that it is designed. We do some functional testing, usually on a single instance of the application. And in that case, usually the delays that are introduced because of the tracing are not so important. In the contrary, in production, when the application is already deployed, and for example, we have to find some weird behavior because of some bug, and we have to trace usually many instances of our application. And here the delays introduced by the tracing are not desirable and should be as low as possible. Even a single if statement in the code which checks if to emit the traces or not can cause significant delays if it is in a place which is executed a lot of times per seconds. Currently, there are two approaches that are used. The one is using a site container. How it works, a helper container is injected into the pod under trace. And the tracing, needed tracing and debugging tools are in that container. And it has direct access to all tasks that are running in all containers in the context of this pod. We can directly attach to those tasks, debug them, extract local logs, and even redirect the traffic, incoming and outgoing traffic, to pass through this helper container to analyze the traffic. This approach is very flexible because we have usually full control of this sidecar container. We can set up there only the tools that are needed for our specific trace case. And also in this case, no modifications are needed to the containers that are traced. This is very suitable for tracing legacy code. But there are some disadvantages. Usually the tools in that help container require root privileges in order to be able to attach to all these external tasks. That's why we have to run the entire pod under trace with root. As we do trust the site container, this is not always the case with the containers under trace. In some cases, it's not desirable to run them with root privileges. It may be dangerous. Also, if we are going to intercept the traffic to pass it through the site container, it will introduce usually big delays. And when we are going to trace a lot of containers, we have to inject a lot of sidecars, which can lead to a big overhead. The other approach that are used when new applications are developed, OpenTelemetry approach, is to instrument our code to emit traces. The traces can be put directly into the code, or some common libraries which are already instrumented to emit traces can be used. The approach is powerful because we can put the logs in the very specific and important logic in our code, and we can collect a very detailed log about this important logic. And here, no root privileges are required because the tracing is actually part of our application. But there are also some disadvantages. The obvious one, the containers must be modified in advance. So this is not suitable for tracing legacy code. It is applicable only for newly developed code. And this instrumentation code, once implemented, is always part of our application. When it's deployed in production, we cannot remove it. It adds also complexity during the development, because developers have to design and implement additionally all this tracing logic. And once deployed, it's very hard to add additional logs. We have to make another release of the application. Is there any other approach that can be used? In the majority of Kubernetes clusters runs on Linux operating system. All these containers that are running inside the Kubernetes node are actually abstraction on top of the namespaces of the kernel. Namespaces are used to implement some isolation between the containers, but from the kernel point of view, all these tasks that are run inside are regular user space processes that can be traced using the existing tracing framework of the kernel. The frameworks of the tracing framework of the Linux kernel has evolved in the past 20 or even 30 years from a simple set of print keys in the beginning, just to dump some information on the console, to a highly optimized framework currently, which has very low overhead. And that's why it is usually enabled by default in the kernels of the majority of Linux distributions. And it also can be used to test production systems in production. So this framework is already there in majority of Kubernetes cluster sitting in the kernel enabled, and it's waiting to be used. But why the tracing in the kernel is more efficient than optimized than tracing in the user space? Let's compare typical tracing implementing a typical user space application and compare that with the existing implementation in the kernel. Usually in our code, in the application, there is some conditional check. In most cases, it is an if statement, which checks if to emit the traces or not. And if this does not look so heavy, it's just a couple of instructions, but if those instructions are in part of the code which is executed 1,000 times per second, then it can introduce some delay, even if the tracing is disabled. And when the tracing is enabled, some lock function is usually called with given string, and the lock function has to write that string into a local file, dump the string on the console, or send the string over the network. And depending on the implementation of that lock function, it can introduce really significant delays. I have seen implementation when the lock function, for example, opens that file for every read and after that closes the file. So for each lock, there is open file, close file, or initiate a new network connection, send the string, and then closes the connection. But even the function is optimized, in any case, writing to a file or sending a string over the network is a very slow operation. Let's compare how it works in the kernel currently, how it's implemented. First, there is no conditional checks in the kernel. Instead of that, there are a few NOP instructions in the places in the code where the traces should be. These are assembler instructions, no operations, just tell the CPU to do nothing. And in most recent CPUs, these instructions are optimized. And usually they take zero CPU cycles. So when the tracing is disabled in the kernel, this is the only overhead that we have, just a couple of NOP instructions that take zero CPU cycles. And when the tracing is enabled, those NOP instructions are replaced with a call to a trace trampoline. That is, the kernel code is modified runtime, one instructions are replaced with the other. This trace trampoline, it receives the same string that should be dumped somewhere, and it writes that string into in-memory ring buffer, which is optimized for lockless reading and writing. There can be multiple writers and readers of that ring buffer without the need to lock the buffer. So this is the overhead in the application context when the traces are locked. Just write that string into memory. Compare that to writing to a file or sending the string over the network. Because, of course, there's limitations because this ring memory is limited inside, it's in memory. But from the application context, the overhead is small, and usually there's some external logic outside of the application which reads the ring buffer during the trace and exports the traces. So far so good, but what can be traced in the kernel and how we can use it to trace containers in user space? First, almost every function in the kernel can be traced. This is by design. When new function is implemented, the kernel developer doesn't need to add any tracing specific logic around it. On compile time, each kernel function is prepended by those NOP instructions automatically. Additional to that, there are static events that kernel developers can put into the code and that can extract very detailed information about some important logic in subsystem in the kernel. Currently, there are more than 2,000 events that dump logs for almost any subsystem of the kernel. Additional to those static trace points, there are dynamic trace points. During runtime, trace point can be set into any offset within any function in the kernel. And the most interesting part for user space tracing are uprops. These are user props. A trace point can be set on any user space function. How it works? Before some application, user space application is executed, it is loaded into the kernel context. And on that point, it is accessible to these tracing frameworks. The trace point can be attached to user space functions. And when the function is called, the trace is emitted. There is also uread props. We can attach a trace point to the return of the function. That's why we can track how many time the function takes to execute. And more interesting, we can track all nested calls inside that function. There is also synthetic events. We can combine any existing static or dynamic trace point to implement some more complex logic. Also, there are CPU performance counters. These are hardware registers that exist in all the modern CPUs that can be used to track the performance of your application, to find what part of your application takes most CPU, most memory, CPU network and or IO resources. And also there is eBPF. Using eBPF, you can design your own trace logic and attach that trace logic runtime to any of the existing trace points in the kernel. This is in the kernel, but how we can use those from user space? There are tools and frameworks for that. Ftrace is the main framework that can be used, those libraries and user space, trace CMD and all these libraries. This can be used to enable, disable those trace points in the kernel, to set new dynamic trace points, to configure different tracing sessions and to execute those tracing sessions in parallel. Each tracing session has its own dedicated ring buffer. So there can be multiple tracing sessions. The other interesting tool is PERF. It uses the CPU performance counter to analyze the performance of your application. It can point you to the exact backtrace of your code, which causes the most CPU usage or the most memory usage using those CPU hardware registers. And if PERF and Ftrace are not enough, BPF trace can be used to implement your tracing logic and to attach it to any of the trace points. So containers are actually, from the kernel point of view, regular tasks. The idea of tracing them is just to use any of these tools and to attach these tools to the tasks that are running in those containers, but we have to define them as the same way from the kernel point of view. The container tracing project is introduced okay, for that, to make that bridge between the tracing in the kernel and the containers running in the Kubernetes cluster. Its main goal is to be simple and efficient in doing quanting, collecting all level system traces per container. It is an open source project originated by VMware at the beginning of this year. It leverages the existing Linux kernel tracing frameworks for tracing containers. It is designed natively for Kubernetes, but can trace any containers running on a Linux system. It does not use side containers and does not modify in any way traced containers. How it works? The idea is very simple. There is a tracer node, which is running inside its own container, and it can detect all containers that are running inside the system. In the tracer node, there is a set of trace hooks, which are implemented using one of those tracing frameworks. And any of those trace hooks can be attached to any of the containers. There is a REST API, which is exposed for the clients, and the traces are read during the trace session are exported outside of the tracer node. As you can see on this picture, there is still no Kubernetes. This is the minimum installation. You can just run that tracer node on the system. It can detect all other containers. In that case, it uses the information from the profile system to extract the list of the containers that are running and the list of tasks for each container and files that are associated with that container or information which is needed for tracing. This is the brief overview of the architecture of the tracer node. It has some in-memory databases, which have meaning only for this instance of the tracer node. There is a logic which periodically looks for containers and extracts for each container a list of tasks and files that are associated with the container and store that information in the container's database. There is a trace session database, which holds the current configured tracing session and their current state. Then they can be running or stopped. Also, the important part is set of these trace hooks that can be attached to any of the containers, and logic to read the traces during the trace and export that logic, that traces outside of the container. And also there is REST API exposed to the clients, which can be used to get the list of available pods in the system that can be traced, a list of trace hooks that can be attached to any of those pods, a list of trace session, and post request that can be used to create a new trace session and to start and stop it, and also can delete it. When running in a Kubernetes, the picture is a bit different. There is a tracer node running on each Kubernetes node. There is a daemon set which is responsible for managing all these tracer node instances. There is one instance of tracer API which exposes the same REST API to the clients. And it acts as a proxy. Each request received by the client is forwarded to all active tracer nodes in the system. Trace session can run on multiple nodes depending on where the containers are running. So each tracer node is responsible only for each local part of the trace session, and the tracer API has a global picture. In that case, tracer node uses the Kubernetes API to extract the list of containers and tasks and that information instead of the profile system. This is the brief architecture of the tracer API. There is a logic which periodically discovers all active tracer node instances and maintains them in a local database. The same REST API is exposed, and logic for API proxy. Each request is forwarded to all active tracer nodes. The replies for them are received in the tracer API, aggregated, and sent to the client as one reply. The container tracer does not store the traces internally. It only can read them from those string buffers. So they should be exported to some external database. Trace exporters are used for that. Currently, there is only one trace exporter implemented that uses the OpenTelemetry SDK to export the traces to external Jaeger database. So currently, having Jaeger installed in the cluster is mandatory in order to be able to collect traces. This is a short picture of the flow of the traces and the life cycle of a trace session. When a request is received on the REST API from the user, a trace session is created, and in that request, the user can specify the name of the pods that have to be traced and name of the containers inside those pods that have to be traced. Wildcard is supported, so we can specify only the part of the name of the pod or all containers or all pods. The session is created internally in the database at that time, but the initial state of that session is stopped. A second request here to be sent to start the session. And when the session is started, the trace hook, which is specified by the user, is attached to all tasks that are currently running in those containers. The tracing in the kernel is enabled, and the tracing is started. At the same time, a reader job is started, which reads the ring buffer, which is dedicated for that tracing session, and exports the all traces from there to external Jaeger database. The session can be started and stopped multiple times, and each time the trace hook is attached or detached from the containers. Can be deleted. There is a short demo that I pre-coded to show you how all this works. This is the list of the pods running in my development Kubernetes cluster. There's a lot of pods. Container tracer itself runs in its contrace namespace. There is only one tracer node in my setup because I have only one node in the cluster and one tracer API instance. This get request can be used to get the list of available pods that can be traced. So this is the list of all these pods. For each pod, there is a name of the pod and a list of the containers that are running inside the pod, and also other information that is used for tracing. This get request returns the available trace hooks. Currently, there is only one trace hook implemented. This is trace syscalls, which collects the system calls that are used by given container. This trace hook is implemented using the ftrace framework of the kernel. Here you have the name of the trace hook and short description of it. This request gets the all currently configured tracing session. Currently, there is no tracing session configured in our system. We can create a tracing session using this session.json helper file. Here we specified what we want to trace. All Postgres pod will be traced in this session, all pods that has Postgres in the beginning of their name, and all containers running inside those pods. The trace syscall hook will be used for this tracing session. It's going to be attached to all these containers. And the name of our session will be demo.oss. Okay, our session is created. With this post request, we are passing this session.json file. The session has unique number that can be used to control that session. The container that is going to be traced, PostgreSQL, running inside the Postgres SQL 0 pod. The initial state of the session is stopped running false. We can use that helper JSON file to run the session, just specifying run true, and put that file to the REST API with the ID of our newly configured tracing session. Now the session is started. The trace hook, system call trace hook, is attached to the PostgreSQL container. The state of the session is running. Currently, it collects the system calls that are used by the PostgreSQL container. We can stop the session using the stop JSON file, just specifying run false using the same API, just passing the stop JSON instead of run JSON. Now the session is stopped. The hook is detached from the Postgres container and the trace is disabled in the kernel. Let's see what traces are collected in this session. This is the user interface of the Jaeger. In my cluster, the name of our session is demo.oss. There is a timeline in the top when you can see when those system calls were called and a list of all system calls. There are 400 system calls for 40 seconds collected. for each system call, we have the name of the system call, the timestamp in the kernel when this event happens. This is in the kernel time space, and the input parameters of the system call. This is system calls and file descriptor 8. System break. Receive from, it got 2000 bytes from file descriptor 8. Okay, this is a short overview how it works. How we can use that information? Currently the project is in its proof of concept stage. It's very limited, it has only one tracing hook available and only one trace exporter to external eagle database. But even with this limited information, a lot of interesting use cases can be implemented. The system calls are actually the interface between the application and the kernel. And all interactions between given container with the external world passes through those system calls. So observing the system calls, we can get some idea what a given container is doing. This is suitable for black box tracing. If you have no idea of the container, I want to get some idea what it's doing. The other interesting idea is using the sequence of the system calls, their frequency and the input parameters, you can train some machine learning algorithm to detect some anomalies in our container. For example, for intrusion detection or for detecting if there is some abnormal execution due to a bug, for example. And the other interesting thing is for workload characterization. Based on the system calls, we can detect if this workload running in the container is CPU intensive, memory intensive, network intensive, or I/O intensive. And based on that information, to make some scheduling decision inside the cluster. This was my final slide. This is the link of the project, if you are interested. Thank you. And there is time for questions.
Just thinking, if it's a more busy system, I guess you will get overwhelmed with the system calls.
It depends on what more busy system means. Actually, it's highly optimized, and I tested it with millions of system calls per second in my laptop. It works. But it depends on the scale. It can be.
Is there a way to filter basically? I want to have a specific container or process?
Yes, all these frameworks can filter per process ID, for example. A lot of filters can be outlined, but all the filter is by process ID. So those tracing sessions are implemented in that way. A list of tasks are passed to them, and only system calls for those tasks are recorded.
Okay. What kind of permissions is that?
Root. But it's only for the container tracer. There is no requirement for the application to being traced to be root.
To be able to use this capability, I have to enable the...
Yes, yes.
I need to have access to this.
Yes. Access to the kernel is only my root.
And like you said, when you mentioned that it is not only for Kubernetes, is it gathering the run container information from any Docker runtime, let's say Docker?
Yes. I tested it without Kubernetes. In the proc file system, there is enough information for that. What containers are running, each list of tasks in which containers files, all this is in the proc file system. Yes, currently yes. Because it's proof of concept. Okay, if there's no questions. If you're interested, we can contribute.